Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, parents will say it isn't true, but what happens when there is a favourite child?
I'm Angelique Nguyen, I'm 20 years old.
I'm Trinity and I am the middle child.
I'm Siobhan and I'm the youngest child. I think I'm the favourite because I always help out with chores.
I'm the rainbow in this family.
I'm athletic, sporty, I'm a hard worker.
I'm the light.
Therefore, I am the favourite.
I'm the favourite.
I'm the favourite depending on the day.
Every parents have their favourite. They just don't want to tell you. But deep down inside, they do have their favourites.
Your favourites, like sisters, you have favourites.
Correct.
With parents, you have favourites.
Because your favourite sister, obviously Trinity and obviously...
Oh my God. If every parent in Australia is telling us that they don't have a favourite child, then I think they're kind of lying to us because we do have a favourite child. But in my household, it's like each child is favourite for that particular week or that particular month. So they do have an option to work their way back up to be my favourite child for that month.
Now, Mum, what do you think?
I love you all equally and for different reasons.
Your mum just told you bollocks because the truth of the matter is she has her favouritism.
See?
All right?
No, she doesn't.
She favours Angelique, whereas me, I'm very balanced.
You're
all favourite every single week. You were 3 weeks ago, so this is 2021. She's old school now, so she's my favourite for this week.
What about next week? Then it's going to switch.
And then
back
if
to
you
me
work
again.
Well, you help out in the house, and you'll be my favourite.
I look like I might have favouritism only
she's
because balancing.
I'm trying to justify and balance your favouritism in this.
There's nothing wrong having a favourite child.
Even though I get told off the most by my dad, I see myself as a favourite still because I see it as him being, you know, loving towards me, so I turn out the right way. So I see things like even if he gets angry, I know he's doing it because it's to make me a better person. So I kind of take those things and turn it around like, oh, I'm the favourite. He gets angry at me the most, it's because he loves me. I'm clearly something special.
My dad explicitly stated that I wasn't the favourite one week. I was like, bit cut. But then I have to remind myself that I don't need anyone's validation, you know what I mean? Out in the real world, I'm not gonna be like, I'm the favourite child. When you're deemed as the favourite child, you do feel, ooh, okay, parents love me more, get a bit of a, you know, higher footing than the other siblings.
Ooh, I got a good amount.
We all are quite competitive, but when I'm not the favourite child, it can be, yeah, a bit sad and a bit brings me down a bit, but it's right, be a bit strong.
Thank you so much for being here. You all think you're the favourite, but for different reasons. Why is that? Trinity, I'll ask you first.
So I would say that I could possibly be the favourite because, you know, I do study hard. I've got a 97.55 ATAR. I try to make my parents proud. I try and, you know, help out around the house, help with the chores. And, you know, I do like my sport, so I do have, you know, balance. So, yeah.
Angelique?
Well, I think I'm the most amazeballs child because, and fave child, because I think I'm just such a bright, like, clown in the family. You know what I mean? And I feel like sometimes when the parents are like, you know, had a bad day, I come and go, boom. Like, I kind of surprise them a bit. So I feel like I bring that happiness to them. And I think it's like, you know, if you have a pet hamster and a pet mouse, which one's, you're always going to have a favourite no matter what. You're going to like something more than the other. Like, mine would be the hamster. You know, yeah.
And Siobhan, what about you?
I think I'm the favourite child because I'm always helping around the house and I'm the baby, so, like, automatically I should be a favourite.
Trinity, what do you have to do to become the favourite child in the family?
I think what you have to do is that you have to be, like, just a good person in general and always help out, you know, be on top of your game and be like, Mum, Dad, OK, I'll help you with the chores, help you cook, help you clean, and, you know, just help out wherever you can.
Angelique, what sort of behaviour relegates you to least favourite?
Oh, I think least favourite. Oh, that's a bit difficult because I think I would say least favourite is the child who does cause a lot of havoc in the family, you know.
Which is.
Which is, even though me, I cause a lot of havoc, but I believe I'm still the favourite because it's good, you know what I mean? It's like that good, friendly banter.
So how do you feel then when you're not Dad's favourite?
Of course, if you find out you're not the favourite, it's a bit upsetting. But I've always learnt that at the end of the day, you've got to be independent. Dad and Mum's not always going to be there. So I feel like you've got to be your own dad. You've got to be your own mum. You know, I'm my own daddy in a way, you know? Yeah.
Siobhan, yeah. Do you think it's natural for parents to have a favourite?
Honestly, I do, but, like, I don't believe that parents should show it because at the end of the day, they love us all equally just for different things and our different unique qualities.
Sandra. We saw you chatting there around the dinner table. How often does this conversation come up?
It actually comes up quite often in our house, and I find that Siobhan tends to bring it up a lot. So she's always trying to find out who's the favourite out of the three of them and extract it from me. But I told you there's no favourite for me,
yes,
so they can never get that out because there isn't.
There is a favourite.
No,
there is a favourite.
So when you're asked that favourite child question, how do you answer it? Is it the same way every time?
Yeah, it's always diplomatic.
Siobhan, do you believe her?
No.
Oh, not at all.
Don't you?
Not at all. She does ask, yeah, quite often.
Deep down, I know that she has a favourite, which is me.
Oh!
And Angelique, what about you? Do you believe Mum?
Honestly, I think I don't believe Mum, you know, because I know she has a favourite too, 100%.
And who is it?
I know it's me. Yeah.
Davey, you don't come across as the diplomatic type. Why is that?
You can see I'm surrounded by four girls in my household.
What?
I don't really have a choice. But, you know, the truth of the matter is favouritism, to me, is a good thing. Because at the end of the day, I want to show them a bit of resilience, right? A lot of people say that having a favourite child is actually a negative thing, but to me, I look at it as a positive thing. Because like, if they're good at something, then you should, acknowledge that. Reward them for that. And if they're not good at something, then obviously they're going to go down to the bottom list of my favourite child. So for them to get back up to the ladder again, then they need to, say, work harder, do more chores around the house, do more fantastic cooking, and then slowly they work their way up to be my favourite child for that particular month.
How do then they lose that top status?
They're on a social media every day. They're back chatting, they don't do the homework, or they don't help out with the chores around the house, and therefore they will slowly, slowly go back to the bottom.
Okay, Lindy, you're the mother of five adult children. Is there a favourite?
No. Kids might disagree with that one, but their perception is that there is a favourite.
Who is perceived to be the favourite?
Taylor is perceived to be the favourite. She's the youngest child, and obviously over time and being so much younger than the others, a lot of the attention came to Taylor.
What was Taylor like as a child?
Taylor was the perfect child. I could say after four others, by the time I got to the fifth, I perfected it.
Taylor, is that how you see things?
It is definitely a running joke in the family that I am without a doubt the favourite child. Not that she didn't love us all equally, but I was pretty well behaved, did good at school, wasn't too rambunctious. my siblings were a little bit more rambunctious, so I think by virtue of that there's a little bit more favouritism, plus they're all a lot closer in age. My next older sibling is 8 years older than me. So there's a lot more sibling rivalry between those four.
Phil, you're the middle child, third in the family. I guess this isn't news to you?
No. I've come to terms with being the black sheep. I'm happy with that.
So from the beginning you kind of felt like Taylor was the favourite?
Oh, yeah, of course. When she was a baby, she was pretty cute, so it's like when you get a brand-new toy, of course it's your favourite.
What were you like as a child?
Oh, I was fat and cute. Curly hair.
As you got older, what were you like?
I was a turd. Best way to put it. Yeah, I worked my way down the ranks pretty fast.
Was Taylor treated differently to you?
Well, she's from a different era. Like, yeah. Better schooling. Stuff like that.
Taylor, were you aware of how different your childhood was to your siblings?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, by the time I was six, I think only my sister was still living with us, but even remembering then, I know we had better living conditions when it was just me and my sister in the house with my mum rather than a mum having to split out resources equally between five kids. So by the time they'd moved out, obviously, she'd moved on further in her career. That meant there was a lot more time and money that could be allocated specifically towards me being only just starting schooling, rather than when all the kids lived at home and had to be split quite equally.
How did you feel about that discrepancy?
Certainly not guilty or anything. I mean, you can't help if you're being born like 10 years later than everyone else and they're all together. Definitely, like, it's, you know, we're all very aware that, like, I had a much easier upbringing by virtue of the fact that I was born later than they did.
Lindy, how do you feel about the different opportunities you were able to give Taylor compared to Phil?
It's a hard one because I was a single parent with five children. So my income was spread across all of the children. And then through the years, as Taylor mentioned, my career progressed as the other kids left home. It was almost like having an only child and pouring your resources into that one child. You do feel guilty that you didn't have the ability to give those opportunities to the other children, but you shouldn't take that away from Taylor because she was able to have that lifestyle.
Okay, Jenna, tell me about your family.
I am a single mother to three little girls. They are 8, 6 and 4. My youngest has Down syndrome, so I'm a full-time carer for her at the moment.
And your middle one also has learning difficulties as well?
Yeah, she's just been diagnosed with ADHD.
Do any of your girls ask you who's your favourite, Jenna?
Yeah, they have asked at times. My oldest feels like it's the middle one feels like it's the oldest, and they probably both feel like it's the youngest.
How do they make that decision? Is it because you're expending more time on one or the other?
So my eldest in particular, she really values one-on-one time. So it's difficult for her to get that with me because obviously her very youngest sister has high needs. And I think also because she doesn't have a diagnosis, that she feels like she's not part of the gang, like she's not special. So the other two have to go to appointments and she just kind of cruises along and she's the easy one. So she feels like she doesn't get the same attention.
Jenna, it's a bit of a taboo question, but do you have a favourite child?
I genuinely don't think I do. I love them all for very different reasons. My eldest I'm probably closest to because I have the most in common with her. And she's older, so she's able to have... I can have a conversation with her. She's got a wicked sense of humour, so she's... like, she makes me laugh. But then the middle one is... she's very energetic and hilarious and also very, very sweet. And then the youngest is just, like, adorable.
With that special connection with your oldest, do the other two pick up on that?
I think the middle one does sometimes, but I am very careful about trying to spend time with them all evenly. So I try my best, but it's hard, yeah, when it's just me.
Does personality play a part in the way you connect with each of your children?
Definitely. My eldest is much more compliant. She's definitely always been the easy one. She didn't care what she used to get dressed in. She didn't care what we did. Like, she'd just be happy to just be with mum. Whereas my middle one has always had opinions right from when she was a baby. She's always had opinions about what she wanted to do, where she wanted to go, what she wanted to wear. But it's been fun getting to know her and getting to know that different personality that I am not used to because it's very different to my personality.
Maggie, you're a counsellor. You've written a number of books on parenting. Is there such a thing as a favourite child?
Yeah, and I think most parents don't plan to have favourites, and it's a moving feast. And we know that you might have a favourite when they're little, but that may actually change as they head towards the teen years. So I think most of us really, if we really looked at it, found there was one child we found was easier to parent, which could then drop into the favourite box, but not necessarily.
It's a pretty taboo topic to talk about though, right?
It is. And most of it, like this lovely banter here, I still got that banter with my four sons because they argue there's one who's a golden child. And so that kind of banter can be quite, you know, mild and not really cause major issues down the track. But when there is a really fixed perception and, you know, the evidence within the family is quite strong, it can actually really impact your sense of self, particularly as you go into the teenage years. And that can become problematic.
Your supposed golden child of your four sons, where does he sit in the order of your children?
Yeah, it's the baby, and it's a very common favouritism thing, and there's a lot of reasons behind that, that the youngest, particularly for women, it's a really big thing to recognise, that's it, I'm not doing this again, and that can be where some of that comes from. But also that tail end of the family, we get a little bit better at parenting, I think.
Siobhan, your dad's favourite this month. Is that because you're the youngest?
No, it's because I always help out, but, like, that does play a part. I'm his baby, so obviously he'll show me a bit more love because I'm his last one. But I do help around the house. I do help him a lot, so, yeah.
Trinity, you're in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
Does that affect you?
Well, Siobhan always loves to roast me, saying, oh, you're the middle child. But to be honest, I actually love being the middle child because I feel like I'm the peacekeeper between the siblings. Like, I'm just there, I'm just vibing, you know what I mean, and seeing what's happening.
Jana, you said you have that special bond with your eldest. Do you think your eldest feels the same way?
No. She quite often tells me that I love the other two more than her because she doesn't get the same one-on-one focus, or she feels like she doesn't because, you know, they've got extra things going on in their lives.
Maggie, what is it that makes a child perceived to be a favourite? Is it more time spent, getting yelled at less, more presents?
It's a little bit of all those things. I think if you go back to the you know, five love languages of Gary Chapman, they have different needs, and if they feel those needs are being met, and also I think it's that I feel loved, I feel connected. I think it's working out the needs of our children, making sure we meet them. But it's a number one, a warm, loving connection, yep, can happen in families who have family, you know, favourites, and they're not as scarred. They know they're loved. They know that's the favourite, but they still know they're loved.
Justin, you've written books about parenting. You have six daughters aged 21 and under. Do they ever ask you who's favourite?
Consistently. All the time.
Right.
There is a perception amongst the older children that the younger ones are increasingly favoured because, you know, we let the 11-year-old do what everyone else had to wait until they were 13 to do.
Yes.
Or as has been said a few times now, your allocation of resources shifts because your circumstances change. So as your circumstances change, you can quite literally provide what appears to be preferential treatment. And that's what favouritism is. It's the consistent application of preferential treatment in terms of resources or affection or attention. You can give those things to your younger children because you've progressed through your life. Maybe you're earning more money, or perhaps you've slowed down at work, or whatever has changed, or there's just less children in the house, depending on how much they're spread out and how many you have. And so we've actually kind of put a bit of a dampener on that conversation. The conversation usually ends something like, you all know that we love all of you and we love different things about each of you, but that's kind of where the conversation stops. And that's because the further I've gone into the research on this particular topic, the more I'm convinced that while it's fun to have lighthearted conversations about it, when children perceive that they are not the favourite, the shadow that it casts through the rest of their life can be significant.
Okay. Maggie, is family banter a way of addressing this sensitive issue, or is it also a way of sort of avoiding the tough question?
I'd like to go the first, just because it's worked in our family. And I thought it was a boy thing, but gee, I'm just really glad I've had the girls demonstrate. It's not. And I really do believe it brings up some of the things that if I hear within the banter a new thing coming up, then I might have wanted to go and have a conversation one-on-one about that particular thing in a private and more discreet way later. So I could take something that's come up and then, you know, create an opportunity to have a chat to that particular son about what that might be. So I think there is a gift in it. And I've always felt that we can get terribly intense with our parenting and worry enormously about things, that we know that sense of humour is one of the protective factors in terms of resilience, because we're not perfect humans either. you know, and our kids need to see that we're not perfect and that we sometimes, you know, have moments where we might be less than perfect and favourite, you know, with whoever we've got in our lives.
Trinity, does this kind of banter ever make you feel hurt or does it make you feel understood?
I feel like the banter, sometimes it can get a bit too much, but I feel like it's good to joke about it and just make it a more lighthearted topic. And I feel like it's good to talk about it and really just get all your feelings out on the table and then you can discuss it and be like, you know, just extinguish these myths.
Rhett, your brother went on to become the front man of INXS. What was it like having the Hutchence name?
Michael was called Hutch. I got called Michael's brother.
There is no equity in a family because everybody's needs are different.
Rhett, you grew up with an older brother, Michael. What was your relationship like as young boys when you were growing up in Hong Kong?
Well, Michael and I were only 2 years apart and I guess we was very close. In Hong Kong, we all had the same friends and it wasn't until we came back to Australia the first time that Michael was going out and I was thinking I was going as well. And he was like, no, I'm going with my friends this time. You can stay here. Up until Hong Kong, we were both equal, you know.
From early on, Michael was seen by your family as the favourite child. We've got a clip from your sister Tina describing that dynamic.
Michael was about 2.5 when Rhett arrived. That was much harder. Michael was a pleaser. You really didn't hear no from him. Where Rhett, his first word was no, it was so obvious that Michael was the chosen one. Rhett felt it. You knew that this child was feeling it. He was a really angry kid.
Rhett, your brother went on to become the front man of INXS, but you were treated pretty differently way before he became famous. When you were about 11, you came home from school. You found your mum with two plane tickets. Who were those plane tickets for and where was she going?
Till that day, I had no inkling anything was actually going on, and it was just a normal day for me and Michael. We walked home from school. I remember noticing a strange car in the driveway, and I remember when I opened up the front door, I noticed there were items in the house which had been moved and stuff like that, and Mum was standing there, and she says, Michael, there's a bag on your bed. Go upstairs and put all your clothes in the bag. We're leaving today. And then there was another lady there, and she was a dial an angel, they're called. They're surrogate nannies that you call to come look after children if you're not going to be around. And that day she left for the airport with Michael and took him away for a year and a half. Now, I don't remember going to the airport. Apparently, I've just blocked it out of my head because it was quite a traumatic experience, I imagine, for a young 12-year-old. But yeah, they left, and I guess, does that come down to favouritism? Like, when you've got a child who is a bit more of a rebel and a bit more, causing more problems and things like that, I guess you have one because they liked a bit more and will be easier to handle. I guess that's what she was trying to do, you know.
So she'd got a job in LA and she's thinking, well, I'll take Michael with me for this period of time.
Yeah. Yeah. And she tried to compensate with me by, you know, every month I'd get a big bag of candy and chewing gum and a couple of T-shirts and stuff like that. But I think that in some ways that damage was already done. I mean, I took it fairly hard and I took another path. My life took another path due to that, I think due to the abandonment and rejection. I didn't even think of that as favouritism. I think it was only when Michael became famous that the favouritism seemed to show in more aspects of our lives, you know.
What was it like having the Hutchence name?
Michael was called Hutch. You know, all his friends called him Hutch. I got called Michael's brother. There was a time when that name could do a lot of things for me. There was a time when I tried to lose that name for a while too, just for people to like me, not knowing that I was Michael's brother. I was at a stage. There was a stage in my life when that was important to me. And I guess there was other stages in my life where by mentioning the fact that I was a Hutchence could get me certain things, get me accesses, get me a table, get me into a bar, get me into a club, get me a free drink, whatever it was, you know.
Did your father favour both of you the same way?
Dad has always, from my point of view, he loved the fact that Michael did what he did and he could enjoy that aspect in his life, but he tried to keep things as equal as possible, you know, I'm pretty sure. Mum was more noticeable in her doings. You know, she'd turn up on tour in the same hotel where Michael was staying out of the blue, her and Tina would, or Michael used to call them the INXS. Because they'd always be around.
Rhett, when you were about 16, you started using drugs pretty heavily. Why was that?
I think to cope with my mother leaving. I went through like 7 different Island Angels. My father was working all the time. And I think I just started down the road. I started drinking, I started smoking pot, and then things escalated to being way down the deep end. You've got your parents who love you, of course. They don't want you to go down that road, and they still show you the love. And that was very important for me. Very important for me.
Did that pain of abandonment carry on beyond your adolescence into adulthood?
Yeah, it certainly did, yeah. Well, I probably used heroin and drugs for approximately 20-something years, and it's only the last 10 years that I've been clean. So I only dealt with those matters of abandonment and rejection the first time when I went to rehab in 92. So up until then, it was something that was, I guess, causing me grief, or it was a reason I got to where I got. And then after that, being able to talk to them and having some clarity in my life, being able to speak with both parents about the issues and coming to terms with that, I slowly grew out of things. And yeah, I was searching for clarity for a long time, and I finally got it. I'm quite happy with it now.
Mandy, you're Rhett's ex-partner. You were together for 4 years. Did you see the impact of all this on him?
Yeah, totally. We got together, I think it would have been our first daughter was born in 95. So we would have got together maybe, 2 years before that. It was really close to when Rhett had just gone into rehab, and so a lot of those issues were coming up. So they were really fresh for him to be looking at all these issues of abandonment and still dealing with this really raw stuff around his own addiction, and then looking up what seeded it. It's incredibly painful going back to that. And I think in our relationship, it was, as friends and as partners, it was something that I felt enormous compassion for him, because he would tell this story over and over. It's like you go back through those stories to try and make sense of it, and you could see how much that had shaped who he was and how much he wanted to get out, of the dynamic that you keep repeating of being in this addictive cycle. But, those kind of things don't get broken easily. And Rhett, really, I could see his deep self-belief at that time was so formed by this moment of abandonment, and it told him that he wasn't chosen, that he was left behind. And he had to find his way back from that. It was very painful for both of us. And his family wanted him to be well. Like there was a magic bullet that was going to suddenly do it, like a good relationship with children was going to fix it. And we all know that when you are going through really deep things as a human being that is seeded as a child, very often having, it's not going to come externally, that kind of change, because it's so deep within, the kind of fabric of who you are.
So how did you both manage that family life, especially when your two children came along? Mandy, I'll start with you.
Look, we're very bohemian. We lived an unconventional life. We smoked a lot of pot. We lived in Byron Bay. We struggled. We really loved each other. We had a great connection, and all the times we were in Bali were always our happiest times, because, there was no way Rhett would use when he was there. And he was a really present, loving dad to his kid. He wanted to turn up. But when you've got all that kind of baggage, it's very hard to just, it doesn't just get left behind, even if you want it to.
Rhett, how was it like for you in those early days of being a father? Did you feel equipped to be a dad?
No, not really. Look, you can hear all the stories, you can read all the books, you can buy all the things that you think you're going to need, but you're never really equipped to be a father. And even though that was my first time at rehab, sadly, it took me, many more years actually to come when I was clean for long, long, long periods of time. And that's something that I've it's been hard to address that in some ways because my children didn't understand why I wasn't around all the time, and the fact of the matter was I would have been useless to them anyway, you know, because I had an ulterior motive all the time. And then when I'd go to Thailand or go to Bali for 6 months and get clean, and but that was time away from the children as well, but it's taken quite some time for them to understand that I needed to do that to get where I am today, because today we have a really beautiful relationship. I mean, we talk and text daily, and now it's just anything we want to say, we can say to each other. It's quite a nice relationship we have.
Mandy, you're the mother to 5 children. Has this knowledge of kind of abandonment and that childhood trauma affected how you parent your children?
Yeah. It certainly does. It does, because you could see the impact. It'd be interesting to ask our children who they thought, you know, and the other kids who they thought the favourite was, because I think their perception's always going to be different. You know, I have a real vested interest in saying I have no favourites, which I totally don't, because there is no equity in a family. It's impossible to have equity because everybody's needs are different. And children are incredible kind of auditors of equity. And when you have a big family, you go to a supermarket, one kid needs a pair of underpants, and you go home and you've bought 5 kids pairs of underpants because you can't handle that one feeling not okay. Like, that just... With 2 kids, maybe you can roll like that, but you can't do that with a big family. I also have a stepdaughter. I have children. The other 4 children are from 3 different partners. There's a whole lot of different things that roll through our family. The youngest child now lives with 2 parents who are married in an ongoing, very settled relationship. I'm a different person to who I was at 28. The way I mother is really different, and what I get. So in a sense, I've learnt as well. At 41 when I had a child, the difference from when I was 28. So I do see the impacts that it has and the narrative that you create as you go. And I've made so many mistakes along the way, heaps of mistakes. You know, and it's really great to be able to blame other people for them, but sometimes you've got to own them yourself. And so I sort of learnt that through the process. Really went to like Rhett's family. I'm really close to Rhett's family. I really love his family. And I'd often speak to his mother about, you know, we had a really close friendship about what happened with Rhett. And we all tell ourselves stories we need to hear to live with ourselves. And her perception was always really different because she loved Rhett and she never felt... She goes, but he was... I thought he'd do better with his father because he was so much hard work and Michael was really quiet. And then I spoke to Michael about it and he goes, that was the worst 18 months of my life. I was so lonely. I was taken away from Rhett, who was like my... You know, I was so close to Rhett. I was taken away. Rhett probably would have done better in LA than Michael, actually, because Rhett had a much more... had a kind of a much bigger personality. Michael was a lot quieter and shyer. But what you learn from that, I guess, is being able to say sorry. And I really feel like probably that thing of, you know, if Rhett's mum had ever been able to say, I made a mistake. And she did actually do that right at the end. She admitted that it was, that she wished she'd never done that. I'd be interested how that helped you, like her ability to finally, like she did admit that she'd made a mistake, because that's a powerful instigator of change in a person, no matter what stage they are at.
Over the years, when we were allowed to talk about it and stuff like that, of course it did help. Even though I'm not sure her excuse or her reasons are what I wanted to hear or needed to hear, the fact that she could actually own it in the end was very helpful, you know.
What did you want to hear or need to hear?
Well, from what happened, I wanted to hear that she was, you know, truly sorry about her decision that she made that day to take Michael away. What I needed to hear was that I was loved and we were equal, I guess, you know.
Did you ever feel any resentment towards Michael?
I don't know if resentment's the word. I admired Michael for what he did. He worked very, very hard for where he got, and it's another stratosphere, that world. And look, I love the fact of, you know, being able to go and taste and try and eat and all these things that probably wouldn't have come into my life at the time. So I never resented that. For me, Michael always tried to knowing his direction, he always wanted the best for me, and he would always tell me that I could do whatever I want, that I could be whatever I wanted to be. I just had to find myself, you know, and something that took a journey that took a long time, but I think now has ended in a space where I'm happy in sitting here and in my life, in my environment.
Justin, what are the effects of thinking that you're not the favourite child?
The effects of thinking that you're not the favourite child can be both intrinsic and extrinsic. So internally, there's things like depression and anxiety that can come over the long term. There's this sense that I'm rejected, I'm not worthy, I'm just not good enough. Now, obviously, it exists on a continuum. There are some children or some subsequent adults who sort of say, well, you know, that was then and we've all moved past that and we've made peace with it and we get through it. And for other people, it becomes a defining characteristic of their lives. It impacts on their desire for work or the heights to which they can rise. It impacts on their relationships with their intimate partners, with their parents. Definitely impacts on sibling closeness. Whether you're the favourite or not, there's still pressure. See, kids who are the favourite, they feel an ongoing pressure to perform, to maintain their status as the favourite. Kids who aren't the favourite, well, they feel pressure because they don't think they'll ever be good enough, and then there's that pressure of, will I ever get to where I want to be? Will somebody ever love me enough? Will somebody look on me with that same level of favour? So there are a lot of impacts, and the research definitely would point us away from having favourites, or certainly from allocating resources in a way where children are perceiving that we favour one child over another, in spite of the impossibility of that task.
Houston, yes. You're one of five children and you grew up in a small village in Indonesia. You describe yourself as the favourite child in your family. Why is that?
Because I was the first born granddaughter from both sides of my family.
When you were a baby, Houston, something happened to make you even more special in your parents' eyes. What happened?
Yes, because there was fire in the kitchen, and also around this, my bed is already on the bed frame, and I'm lucky to be survived.
And was that story repeated in your household a lot as you grew up?
Yes.
You were always seen from that point on as the miracle child?
Yes.
How did that affect your relationship with your siblings?
My little sister is really different age gap with me, so I don't really have anything to do with them, so I don't have much connection. It's my brother with me, it's 1 year's gap, so I'm more likely communicate with him, but until now, I don't have any, what is that called?
You don't have a real heart relationship with your brother.
Yes, yes.
Has that changed over time?
Not really. Still like that.
When you look back at your childhood, Houston, how do you feel about it?
I feel so happy because I have everyone love me, like, because I'm the first girl in there, like first granddaughter, like that. But in some way, they treat me special, but it's not doing good to me because I feel like more selfish and a bit more like expectation a lot from people. Like every time I see people hoping like, oh, you will treat me like my family treat me. I feel like that, so it's not that good.
Because you had so much love showered on you, you expect that's what you should be receiving all the time.
Yes. Yes, expectation.
How does that play out as an adult? How do you sometimes maybe act when you don't receive all the love that you feel like you should?
Yeah, I just get annoyed and I feel like, oh, am I something wrong with me? Am I not good enough?
Kelly, you're Houston's daughter. Yeah. Do you kind of see that aspect come out of your mum sometimes?
I can sometimes tell that, like, she needs that bit of attention and like the attention to the spotlight, but in many ways, like, she's an incredibly selfless mother, but there are certain aspects where I'll notice that she does crave that little bit of attention.
Leanne, you grew up in Malaysia. You were the youngest child in a family of five. As children, were you treated equally?
I would have to say no. My mother ran the household like the operation you see in The Sound of Music, because my father expected breakfast and he expected all the children to be seated and dressed for dinner. So my mother fed everybody, dressed everybody in the order of your birth. So she never missed anybody out. So when I was very young, I didn't notice that. I did notice that as I was growing older, my brother would get a separate present. But you didn't think of it as being unfair. It was the order of things and it becomes naturalized, you know. And I became very embarrassed about it when external people like my boyfriend, who's now my husband, would comment why my brother gets to do certain things, because I had accepted that. Because you're a child, you don't know any better, so.
Can you remember how you felt at the time when your brother was getting more than you?
I only felt it when it had to do with food. Food for me is an expression of love, so.
And he would get more food than you?
I think he'd get one whole fruit by himself and the rest of us had to share everything else. You notice that he behaved differently. He knew he was the firstborn of the firstborn, so he was pretty set up for life.
When you were about seven, your circumstances changed. Your siblings then perceived you as your mother's favourite. Why?
When I was about six or seven, my mother left the home and she took me. I think everybody felt abandoned. I had no words to describe it. It was just the way it was.
Did your siblings act towards you differently? Were they jealous?
Well, I didn't have any contact with my family till I was in my tweens, I think. And they came back on weekends. I didn't like them. My elder sister is used to having everything her way. And I once had a conversation with my mother. And she said to me, "You're the lucky one." So I never raised any issues with her.
How do you think your siblings felt about you being the only one to go with your mother?
I think they felt very abandoned. I feel there's a lot of resentment. It is articulated as we grow up. But you know when people say, "I am responsible for my mother because I am her favourite child." But I didn't choose it. So that's where it is.
Can you explain that a bit more, that feeling of being responsible for your mother?
I think my mother grew up in a time when people had roles. You were a mother, you were a wife, you were a mother. And when her marriage broke down, she failed in her books as a wife. And she failed as a mother because she had to leave her children, except for me. And she never had the sense of worth. My mother was a very charming person. She sang, she danced, she talked. She was a delightful person. But every day at night when she went to sleep, she'd be unhappy. And so I had to cope with that. And in some sense, I became the perfect child. Because I was mostly with my mother, I felt in later years, I've come to realize it was a very difficult time for everybody, not just for me. You be the unfavored child, you have difficulties. You are the favored child, you have difficulties. I feel burdened by being the favorite child. Because I was the only child, I feel burdened in many ways.
Have you spoken about that burden with your siblings as adults?
My family is very important to me. They are all that will remain one day of my birth family. But I feel it's like a jigsaw puzzle. I have missing pages. Nobody will talk about it because sometimes I try to talk about it. It's very painful. Everybody says, what are you talking about? You had mum. You know, you had the best, you had the prize. What's there to complain? But that prize was very painful. It came with a lot of sacrifices.
Is it important for you, for your siblings, to understand that sacrifice?
I don't think it matters to them. I think you have the prize. You know, you have a big trophy, so it's heavy, but you carry it because it's your prize, you know.
We're all doing the best we can, but what we do know is that parents are also being driven by their own wounds from their own childhoods.
I think people want to sweep things under the carpet because there's so much hurt. The more you hide it inside, the more destructive it becomes.
Euston, Kelly is an only child. Was that a conscious decision?
Yes.
Why?
Because I feel like if only child would be get a lot like full attention from the parents, like I was brought up before. So my decision already, I only one, that's all.
And you'd never then have to choose a favourite?
Yes, exactly.
Kelly, has your mum spoken to you about this decision?
She's always made it clear that she just wanted to have one child. I wish I had siblings. I feel like...
Oh, that's making me feel bad.
Gets a bit lonely, but no, I do get full attention and special treatment, so...
Leanne, how connected are you to your family now?
It's like living with someone, but not talking about things that matter to you, just to keep the peace. I think people want to sweep things under the carpet because there's so much hurt. But I found out about hurt is that the more you hide it inside, the more destructive it becomes. It isn't for myself. I don't need my family. I am very happy where I am. But I honour my parents' story by still being connected to my family. But unfortunately, it isn't as good as I would like it to be. But we all strive to have better relationships with people who matter to us. I think keeping the lines of communication open is a good way to do it. There is a lot of healing that can come from talking about things, you know.
Maggie, what can families do to make sure that this favouritism doesn't turn into a negative experience in a household or even into the future?
Well, I think it's about honest communication. We'd all love to say that we do it, but I'm not sure that we do. I really recommend that whoever's co-parenting, if you are more than, you know, just one, is have a check-in every now and then. But if you've got one child who is complaining a lot, that they're not the favourite child, I'd probably have a really good check-in around that, because there must be some core needs that are not being met for that child. And if you can nip it in the bud early, then it's probably a lot better than letting it fester. And you need to kind of see that, be grateful for that feedback from your child rather than see it as a criticism of the way you're parenting, because human nature is so difficult and unpredictable. And, you know, we're all doing the best we can, but what we do know is that parents are also being driven by their own wounds from their own childhood. So at different times, it's unconscious the way that we interpret behaviour. But if you've got that, you know, absolutely dive in and explore it if you can.
How would a conversation actually play out if your children asked you whether they're the favourite or not?
Oh, like I just go to that glib one that says you're all my favourites, but some days some are more favourite than others, because that is the nature of what we're doing. Some days that, you know, if your child's just drawn lipstick pictures all on the wall, you're not going to feel quite as amenable to them being the favourite child in the moment, and yet that's quite normal for childhood development. And I think we've got to be realistic around that, that our children are evolving as humans, and most parents are absolutely doing the best they can. So I think we need to have a bit of a reality check around
what we really are capable of doing as parents, and being really honest that, gee, it can be tough some days.
How do you have a conversation when a child perceives they might not be the favourite? Do you talk to them about perception?
Absolutely. So if a child feels I'm not the most favourite, there's probably a hunger there and a need of connection that's not being met as well as they could be met. So it's how could I step up? It doesn't mean to say we suddenly start spoiling them or overcompensating. It's that we might need to respond to what is that? What is it within that child's world that feels like it's not being met by the parents?
Trinity, if you ever thought of having a child or children, would you ever pick a favourite?
Honestly, I would try not to, because I think that you should love all your children equally, but obviously you would love them for different reasons. You know, everyone brings something different to the table, and yeah, just acknowledge and accept that.
So if they asked you that, that's what you'd say to them?
Yeah, I'd be like, I love you all for different things, different reasons, you know, just vibe it out.
Angelique?
Well, I'm firstly not having children. I'm going to be like that mum with all these dog animals and like those farm animals. But like if it comes to my pets, I think obviously I'll love them all different. But at the same time, I did have two dogs and I did love one more than the other.
Why?
Oh, favouritism right there.
I don't know. It was like a heart. Like I felt something in my heart towards one specific dog. It was weird. It was like a dog-animal connection. It was weird.
Siobhan, what about you?
Well, I'm quite young, so I don't want to think about it. But if I did have kids, I feel like sometimes I would have favourites depending on obviously what they're doing. So if one's acting up, I would obviously like the other one better at that stage in life, but I would all love them equally.
That is all we have time for. Thank you so much to all of you for sharing your stories.